Oh my gosh, what's happening? Okay. Let me get my slides back. Hi everybody. Thanks so much for that introduction, Damian. Thanks for having me here. I've had a great day. It's been really fun. And it's been an extra treat to join an old friend of mine, Marco Abel, who's I realized today, Marco, it's hard to see in the lights, but Marco and I have known each other for 20 years now.
Right here. Yeah. Yeah. Yes.
20 years now. And it's also his birthday. Happy birthday.
It is his birthday.
Thank you.
I can say that because I've known him for 20 years. let's see. I wanted to mention, too, that when Damon contacted me, as he mentioned, when he invited me to speak on post-human futures, he almost immediately made it clear that it's okay to talk about old stuff. And so I really was grateful and very happy to do that. So before, or really as I dive into some of that old stuff, I'm going to move this keyboard so I don't mess my slides up. Specifically Aristotle, I want to take this opportunity to reflect on this idea of post-human futures, which is something, as Damian mentioned, that I've been toying with since my stint in graduate school. Oh, it's doing it again. Sorry. I don't know what I did. I'm going to move this way. Okay, since my stint in graduate school, when I was reading a lot of Foucault and a lot of Haraway and Deleuze and Nietzsche, thinkers that I imagine many of you know well. And so I'll offer a few thoughts on post-humanism and how I see, I think this is complementary to what David just said, but how I see animal studies and animality studies fitting in, and why, and this is where my latest work comes in, why the discipline of rhetoric matters, I think, for animal studies and has been kind of shunted to the side in that area of inquiry. So first, a few words about post-humanism. David mentioned this piece. This is a special introduction to a special cluster of essays that I collaborated on with John Muckelbauer in 2000, where we characterize, it's highlighted there, the post-human as an attempt to engage humans as distributed processes rather than as discrete entities. One vivid instance of what I think we meant by humans as distributed processes is this recent New York Times article about the troubled Google cars. Anybody see this article? This is very, very recent. Those are those self-driving cars. And this one awesomely describes the car as too safe. That is, it follows driving laws too perfectly. So the piece mentions this 2009 test in which the Google car arrived at a four-way stop and it became paralyzed because none of the other three cars driven by humans actually would come to a complete stop because everybody's just trying to, you know, as one does, right? So the laws programmed into the car are a really good concrete example of humans as distributed processes, and also the practice of driving is so conditioned by human culture that, as Professor Pfister and Professor Woods will tell you, in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, where locals observe something called the Pittsburgh left, which is a custom and not a law, a Google car would not stand a chance. So another piece that I worked on more than a decade ago was with David Gunkel, who's a scholar of communication technology at Northern Illinois. And there, we framed post-humanism with this cartoon from a New Yorker in 2002. So this cartoon is funny, of course, because, or maybe you don't think it's funny. It's sobering, right? It's both funny and sobering because it imposes the familiar medical model of human bodies onto the cosmos. And it positions humans as this planet's most dangerous viral inhabitants or something of an infestation. So post-humanism invites us to think about human interactions with technology as well as ecology from an other than human perspective. Or at least from a perspective that does not begin with the human and also end with it. And here you might hear echoes of Nietzsche, who asked us, and I think he would have asked us in all caps if he could have, to consider how the gnat feels the flying center of the universe within himself. Post-humanism, like so many posts and so many isms, complicates age-old hierarchies, human machine, human in nature, which prompts me to add another plug for your last speaker in the series, John Durham Peters. I just finished reading his book, The Marvelous Clouds, and he's really kind of go to town on some of those binaries, as you can tell from David's preview. So you're in for a treat in March. Now, the concern with non-human animals in the humanities comes right out of these same impulses to question the presumed order of things. Donna Haraway's Cyborg Manifesto, which was first published in 1985, so 40 years ago. And then in Simian Cyborgs and Women in 1991, that had this image on the cover, which showed and it critiqued machine and human, machine and non-human animal as the key defining boundaries of the human. So that boundary crossing, or what I think Haraway liked to call couplings, was the focus of early posthumanism, and by now I call it a presumption, along with the critiques of traditional notions of humanism that such convergences entail. So the aim of my current work is to show the importance of rhetoric, as I mentioned, to these conversations, especially to the conversations coming out of a sub-area of posthumanism known as animal studies. And also, I mentioned this earlier in the grad student meeting, animality studies, which I think Marianne de Koven aligns specifically with posthumanism. And that piece is in the 2009 special issue on the animal in PMLA, if you want to check that out. The greatest concentration of work in animal and animality studies can be found in literature and philosophy, two disciplines whose relationships to rhetoric have been complicated at best. So while scholars in the humanities have tended to take interdisciplinary approaches to their work on animals, rhetoric does not typically appear on the often long list of disciplines informing these approaches. That omission may come at a cost. Rhetorical theory and rhetorical education have historically been paths traveled by animals into other disciplinary traditions. The progymnasmata, for example, which many of you know as those school exercises designed to prepare children for rhetorical studies, those teem with reptiles, mammals, insects, and birds, even as they blend rhetoric with poetics, with law, and with what would later come to be known as science. So that blending occurs precisely because these exercises were for centuries a bedrock of education in the West. And yet scholars focused on animals and animality during periods when the progymnasmata flourished tend not to consider these exercises in their accounts of imaginative cross-species encounters. And this, despite the fact that writers as illustrious as Shakespeare and Milton were known to have practiced these exercises. One complicating factor, I think, is language. Language, or specifically speech or logos, long the core of rhetorical studies, is a constant sticking point in animal and animality studies. This slide offers a couple of outtakes. John Muckelbauer, again, follows the problem back to the Greeks when he notes that animals have always been part of the stories told in the name of rhetoric. And here, Diane Davis links the ignoring of animals in rhetoric to the dominance of representation, self, reason, understanding, and so on. So at stake for these two, and they're absolutely correct, is rhetoric's persistent humanism. Such humanist presumptions may also be challenged, though, from within the texts and traditions thought to have fixed them. Animals return time and time again in rhetorical texts, carrying lessons and serving as partners in feeling. So one really important text for rhetoric was written by Aristotle, of course. As many of you know, he wrote a number of treatises on ethics, on philosophy, on biology, and on politics. And I'll say more about those later. But the rhetoric is among the first and certainly the most famous book to systematize the art of rhetoric. And right in the middle of it, as those of you who read my book's introduction know, a dog walks in. These dogs are calm, perceptive, and responsive. They turn up in Aristotle's discussion of calmness, defined as a settling down or a quieting of anger. Even dogs, Aristotle writes, show that anger ceases toward those who humble themselves, for they do not bite those sitting down. Now, translators of Aristotle like to link this passage to a dramatic scene in the Odyssey in which Odysseus, about to be attacked by vicious dogs, sank to the ground at once. And that scene, I think, is depicted nicely in this 19th century drawing, although there's supposed to be four dogs, so. But anyway, two are fine. who cares? So Odysseus sings Homer, sat down knowingly with characteristic cunning, for he, quote, knew the trick. It's a quote of obviously one of the translations. J.H. Freeze's translation of the dog's passage in the Rhetoric includes a note that simply cites this line from Homer as cultural context. George Kennedy's note, though, is hilariously more overtly cautionary. He kind of cites the passage from Homer and then sort of says, don't try this at home. Let's not trust him too much here. So what is this cross-species encounter doing at nearly the center of a treatise about an art thought by most to be so thoroughly human? I believe it matters that dogs show up in this particular text, that is the rhetoric, and in this particular part of the rhetoric, toward the beginning of the famous discussion on rhetoric and pathos, which is of course the Greek word for feeling, or emotion. We can talk about that if you want. I would even hazard that the humans strategically making themselves lowly before dogs behaving angrily also matters. This passage, that is, and I love the way that drawing helps to illustrate this sort of physically, breaks with the hierarchy of humans over non-humans, so often attributed to Aristotle. But it does much more than complicate that presumed hierarchy. It shows humans and non-humans mutually assessing dispositions and altering their own in response. So the image offered by this passage contains at least two ways that non-human animals function in pre and early modern rhetoric in the West. Their response, at first, is their response to movements and energy, and second is their role as partners to humans in sensing and feeling. Now, Aristotle's dogs illustrate the combined effect of humility and submission. The dogs, in this case, bring to life, they vivify Aristotle's point because dogs were co-present in the everyday lives of the Greeks. An image of a dog becoming calm before a submissive animal, human or otherwise, is easily conjured out of that everyday familiarity, and probably not just through Homeric epic, although that was so kind of everyday in terms of education, that it, I would say that too. Non-human animals and their noisy, kinetic movement fill the world with their sensory material and fill out the art of rhetoric in that same way. So rhetoric, as many of you know, has a long tradition in Western thought, one that usually focuses on words and the work they do in the world. But what I'm talking about here is more than that. I'm talking about the energies, bodies, processes, and movements involved in communicative exchanges. Such exchanges, full of energy and movement, and here it's like flapping and wagging and sniffing, call on the variety of senses, and they are not, and have never been, limited to humans. In fact, as I show in my just completed book that Damon mentioned, non-human animals turn up in rhetoric's theoretical and instructional texts when sensation matters the most, thereby bringing rhetoric to its or to the senses. So that's the refrain of the history I do there, which notices the convergences of rhetorical energies, human and non-human, and it does so by trying really hard to press past the representational role of animals in text to consider the constitutive work of animals, which is to say, that non-humans helped to make the art of rhetoric as it was theorized, practiced, and taught. So that, in a nutshell, is the argument of my book. And I'm glad to talk about the book, its shape, or any of the individual chapters later on. We'll probably have plenty of time for discussion. And I even have a slide prepared for that situation. I control the Q&A, too. But if you wanted to see it, I could walk you through it. I just don't want to do that now. So now, though, I'm going to sort of dive into the material on which I base the book's first chapter, which is on Aristotle. I was going to try to graft the dog's head onto the book. No, can't do that. I resisted for some time giving Aristotle his own chapter, and I was content to simply have him kind of smeared all over the book. But then I realized that Aristotle is made to be responsible for the seemingly decisive split made between humans and other animals. That, and he kept hijacking my introduction. And for the purposes of this talk and this lecture series, I want to examine the clean split that scholars in animal studies have loved repeatedly to attribute to Aristotle. So here are two representative examples, but the footnote in my book is like really long with many, many examples. So here's one from a scholar in the UK with an emphatic sort of, this began with Aristotle. And then here's another from a scholar in, I believe, in comparative literature, Ed Wesleyan. She's not the only one who uses this phrase since Aristotle. It's become kind of commonplace. It kind of stands in for so much. And it really just has become kind of the banner of animal studies. So these allegations against Aristotle are fairly simple. He set down an enduring distinction between humans and other animals. That distinction hinges on logos, speech, or reason. And simply put, humans have it, and other animals don't. But that's at least how the story gets told. So these accounts are usually based on this famous passage of the first book, The Politics, where Aristotle declares humans to be the animals that have logos, and the phrase there is zoon, logon, ekon. And this passage in The Politics is really a defining moment of humanism, and it may be worth another look, especially in conjunction with Aristotle's writings on other animals, on the soul, and on rhetoric. Revisiting those words with more care helps to draw out the perceptive core of existence shared by all animals. This perceptive core is too often skipped over by scholars of Aristotle's rhetoric and politics, trained as they are to follow the path of logos. But leaving behind the alogos, that is the without logos, as a category, or even presuming that Aristotle did so, comes at a cost. And that cost is a more comprehensive, fully fleshed out theory of rhetoric. The trick, I think, is to approach alogos as something other than the absence of logos, to identify in positive terms what takes the place of logos. In other words, the little a there in front of logos does privative work, that is, it stands for privation or kind of withoutness, but the withoutness does not necessarily need to be formulated as a deficiency or a withholding. So alogos, after all, names actually a part of the soul for Aristotle. It's a part that operates without reference to rationality. It is non-rational as opposed to irrational. So the question becomes, if not logos, then what? A logos or not logos may be therefore usefully approached as a capacity or set of capacities. And resources for approaching the term a logos as a capacity rather than a deficiency may be found in texts composed by Aristotle himself and in the capacities exhibited by non-human animals that appear there. So Richard Sarabji is kind of all over this. He's a philosopher long preoccupied with Aristotle's writings on non-human animals, and he provides this nice clue to what animals are doing there. He said, if they must be denied reason or logos, and with it belief or doxa, then their perceptual content must be compensatingly expanded to enable them to find their way around the world. So this perceptual expansion occurs, though, on more than a content level, on which I think Sarabji leaves it. So what I found, though, is that when you look at this question in the context of rhetorical theory, non-human animals expand into the role of proxy feelers, and they're often carriers of sensation. So in such a view, an insistence on non-human animals being a logo, which is a plural, is as much an attribution as it is a denial or a rejection. And this attribution of expansive and oftentimes intense feeling to non-human animals helps account for their constitutive role in the teaching and the shaping of rhetorical theory. Such constitutive force is not, or is not always, as one might surmise, a simple constitutive outside. It doesn't merely help to identify logos by simply not having it. Instead, this constitutive role works through instruction, illustration, and also what I'm finding is a consistent presumption of cross-species likeness. So non-human animals do the work of sensation, and far from remaining totally separate from the logos they've been denied, they fold back on it and enrich it. They lend logos energetic life through sounds, shapes, textures, and movements. And this doesn't mean that non-human animals are only or even merely rhetorical objects or figures, but instead that they infiltrate rhetorical life worlds by means of encounters both imaginative and real. Now, in short, in pre- and early modern rhetorical theory, and especially in Aristotle's key informative texts, non-human animals exert a pull, and that pull is toward feeling. So non-human animals have capacities to be uniquely instructive for political life and for rhetorical theory, and Aristotle does not underestimate those capacities, nor should we. And so for the next few minutes, I want to work through the passage in The Politics that I mentioned, which is one that positions Aristotle as the one who drew the bright line between humans and non-human animals. So I want to first show where and how sensation, that is the Greek for sensation, of course, is aesthesis, where we get aesthetics. So I want to show how sensation show where and how it shows up, and then I'm going to place that passage next to passages in other of his works that help to draw out the category of alogos as a kind of dynamic, lively, positive set of capacities. and then equipped with a more fleshed out positive notion of a logos self, then return to the rhetoric to see how non-human animals help to pull rhetoric both outside of verbal language and outside of rationality, therefore filling out rhetoric, both the treatise and the art. So here, in three slides, is the passage where Aristotle famously denies logos to animals except for human ones. And I don't tend to read slides, but I'm going to read these, because this is pretty central. So that man, the first one is, that man is much more a political animal than any kind of bee or any herd animal is clear. For as we assert, nature does nothing in vain, and man alone of the animals has speech. Okay, this is the most famous of Aristotle's assertions. Logos is that which man alone of the animals possesses. This assertion is too often, I think, where scholars stop. But the remainder of the passage, the one that contains the second assertion, deserves attention as well. He frames it according to aesthesis, or perception here, or sensation. We can talk about that distinction too. The voice indeed indicates the painful or pleasant, and hence in present and other is present, sorry, and in other animals as well. For their nature has come this far, and they have perception, the word there is aesthesis, is derived from it, perception of painful and pleasant, and signal these things to each other. Okay, that's pretty interesting. So then there's the second assertion of this distinction here, which begins with a comparison between the work of logos and the work of sensation or perception, and that goes like this. Sorry, this is a long one, but I'll work through it. Speech serves to make visible the advantageous and the harmful, and hence also the just and the unjust. For it's peculiar to man, compared to the other animals, that he alone has perception of good and bad, and just and unjust, and the other things of this sort. And community in these things is what makes a household and a city. So in elaborating this doctrine of zoon, logon, ekon, the passage moves from logos to sense perception, and curiously, it doesn't go back. So in remaining with aesthesis, the passage introduces the capacity that binds all animals together, human and non-human, in Aristotle's writings on the soul, on zoology, on ethics, and even, as I'll show, on rhetoric. So in the politics, this distinction supports Aristotle's assertion that it is clear why man is a much more political animal than any kind of bee or herd animal. The comparison here implies that other animals are also political, just not so as intensely so as anthropos. Supporting this reading is Aristotle's characterization of politica, or you know, political beings, in history of animals, as he characterizes those as those which have some one common activity. A characterization he supports with a list of examples: humans, bees, wasps, ants, and cranes. So without the connection to the history of animals, it might be easy to overlook the centrality of aesthesis in the politics passage. But the link across these two treatises and the non-human animals occasioning the link ought to alert readers to this cross-species comparison happening here, as much as to their differentiation. So where the politics passage unravels the claim about logos to this core of perception, that unraveling is enabled by and shared by the non-human animals considered a logos in this scheme. So reading this passage is a gloss on that phoné logos distinction, which is pretty interesting, the sound-speech distinction, rather than the logos-a logos distinction, returns more forcefully to evasive aesthesis or sensation. Phoné, as it appears in the middle of that long politics passage, and here's that second slide again, names the way that animals signal a perception of painful and pleasant, while logos serves to make visible the advantageous and the harmful, and therefore also the just and unjust. So the difference repeats in the second section, where Aristotle ascribes to anthropos alone a perception of good and bad and just and unjust and other things of this sort. So read in this way, the politics passage places logos at a perceptual remove from the polis, for logos serves to make visible a perception of a just world, to, in a way, hand it over to or share it with other perceiving humans, thereby creating, or in some sense, maintaining some sort of associative bond. So that handing over a perception, at least in this passage, constitutes a body of citizens for Aristotle. Now this emphasis on sharing perception matters because it places all animals on the same plane in the way that they participate in their world. And on such a reading, the differences between sound and speech kind of diminish, for both are deemed the means by which animals exchange perception. But what humans are deemed to, one, perceive, and two, to make visible to others, bears more of the cross-species difference than logos itself for Aristotle. So what I mean by that is this. The role of logos is making common a sharing, it's a sharing of perceived life worlds, which could well operate as a general definition of rhetoric, and which also applies to voice more generally, which includes sounds made by non-humans. Now the process of making visible through logos abstract principles such as goodness or justice is embedded in Aristotle's very definition of the political, but this does not mean that even that more direct sensations of pleasure and pain, which is the, which are the capacities of all animals, are excluded from that definition. Indeed, as Sorabji points out, and as philosopher Jessica Moss elaborates with considerable depth in her book on Aristotle and Fantasy, it's amazing. Aristotle's treatise on the soul, De Anima, points to the aesthesis of pleasure and pain. He points them toward good and bad as such, thereby further softening this distinction he makes in the politics. So taking this aesthesis example of Politica and elsewhere he talks about it in terms of political friendship, taking that back to the history of animals helps to make better sense of the cross-species distinctions Aristotle asserts rather emphatically in that treatise. And here is one. He says the only animal that is deliberative is man. And then he goes on. He says, and I don't have this on a slide, but he says, many animals have the power of memory and can be trained, but the only one which can recall past events at will is Anthropos. Now, when temporality, the preservation of past perceptions through memory and future-oriented projective work of deliberation are added into the mix, what results is a highly circumstantial or contingent rhetorical account of aesthesis, one that Aristotle and other texts does not restrict to humans. Non-human animals, as creatures of the now, help to clarify this contingency because they embody it. Any sense of the character of an action requires perception, or as Aristotle phrases it, and I love this, the judgment is in the perception. Now, embedding this phrasing in the centrality and immediacy of the aesthesis or of sensation, a link between circumstance and perception that needs to be drawn out and theorized in the context of rhetoric, and the most sensible place to begin is Aristotle's treatise on that subject. So here we go. For all the talk of Aristotle's exclusion of non-human animals from modes of reason, a notable and mostly consistent logic of cross-species likeness pervades his writings. As I've tried to show with my reading of the Politics passage, the differentiation results from a comparison where Aristotle finds degrees of similarity. Indeed, when Aristotle's biological and metaphysical treatises are considered, few capacities that draw on perception in something like reason exclude other animals. Neither knowledge, nor critical acumen, nor prudence, or phrenesis, definitely not spirit, or thumos, and not even fantasia, or imagination, which is something we talked about in the earlier session with the grad students. I want to run through a selection of sort of evidentiary examples here, fairly quickly, but not so fast that you can't jot down the passages if you want to look at them. While restricting the amount of gnosis, or knowledge, for some animals in the generation of animals, Aristotle nevertheless makes the assertion that sensation is, of course, a sort of knowledge. So he hedges. In De Anima, Aristotle characterizes all living souls as having the ability to judge and sense. And in the Nicomachean Ethics, Aristotle asserts that prudence is shared across species. This comparative logic, which might usefully be called a logic of likeness, courses through Aristotle's consideration of humans and other animals, especially in the context of rhetoric and language. Now, more often than not in the rhetoric, animals appear as specific kinds of animals, dogs, horses, and birds, but Aristotle does not mention, or he does, sorry, mention non-human animals generally. He speaks of alon zoon, so other animals, a few times in the treatise. And the first mention of alon zoon appears in a discussion of topics for epideictic rhetoric, which those of you who study rhetoric know that's the rhetoric of praise. Now here is here's that passage actually from the beginning of the chapter. And I just want to sort of give you an overview of the moves that he makes in this passage. It's kind of, you know, regardless of their sincerity and regardless of the object, Aristotle seems to be suggesting that propositions of praise can and indeed ought to be treated in the same way. So in other words, no matter what the orators are praising, the values remain constant. The passage therefore sets forth a kind of logic of cross-species likeness, a logic that persists in the calm dogs example with which I began. So likeness, albeit an intra-species likeness, in fact, is the explicit focus when a flurry of non-human examples turn up in the rhetoric two chapters later in chapter 11. Indeed, the rhetoric's discussion of pleasure presents something like non-human community. No fewer than three direct mentions of non-human animals occur in this passage, and I've bolded them for you. This is, of course, not surprising since nature, or phusis, is the topic, and animals were and are presumed to be guided by nature. But extending this logic of likeness from humans to horses and back again is not simply a naturalizing move. Take the proverb jackdaw by jackdaw, the ancient Greek version of birds of a feather flock together. A proverb that Aristotle mentions again in Nicomachean Ethics, where he's noting varied opinions on whether friendship stems from similarity or difference. And this feeling of pleasure through similarity is, according to the logic of these proverbs, shared across species. And so humans and non-humans alike are presented as capable of experiencing pleasure through association. When Aristotle offers these proverbs about animals, he has it both ways. Birds hanging out with birds, like them, birds like Ben, illustrate the workings of human filiation, but the proverbs themselves do not consider human non-human association like other passages do. He clumps together members of the same species there. And yet a looser association may persist in the act of observing that association, which is another point implicit in the flocking proverbs. The horses, the beasts, and the jackdaws in these proverbs are sensible objects, and this is kind of a key point. They exhibit observable behaviors that are analogous to human behaviors, but they also themselves sense. So this sensible sensation, in my view, along with the shared and oftentimes analogous life worlds, is what makes non-human animals so readily available as examples in Aristotle's views on human behavior. And it's their ability to flexibly and at times simultaneously perform both roles, to be at once analogous to humans and to intensify feelings, that accounts for the persistence of non-humans in theories of rhetoric and of language. So the examples I've discussed so far consider the logic of likeness that puts forward non-human animals as subject for speeches and as sensing and sensible objects, binding them with human animals by analogy. So while other animals may receive honor, beasts are deemed profoundly deficient in this ability to confer, or in the case of shame, to remove honor. And this makes sense given where Aristotle's exclusion actually happens, that is on the perception of abstract virtues such as good and bad. The politics passage and its emphasis on the idea of aesthesis with a stress on feeling helps to make sense of a few perplexing passages in the rhetoric. So the passage that I want to talk about is too syntactically dense to really show it to you on a slide. So instead of showing it to you, I just want to give you the gist of it. He says, honor and reputation are pleasant. It's nice to be famous, right? Kanye West would agree. A person is pleased when he perceives himself as important, and the pleasure intensifies when other believable folks say so too. So these include neighbors, friends, fellow citizens, etc. And these kinds of people are more likely to tell the truth than their opposites, since, and here's the part I'm interested in, no one pays attention to honor or reputation accorded by those he much looks down on, such as children or animals. So I want to move to a nearly identical mention, which makes it really interesting that he kind of makes this move twice in book two of the rhetoric. But this is a discussion of shame. So in a catalog of those before whom people feel shame, Aristotle helpfully elaborates the same points as he does in the discussion of honor. He's really good at saying, yeah, this thing here. So, toward the end of his discussion, Aristotle again invokes those pesky children and animals with this line. But on the whole, they, that is people, are not ashamed before those whose reputation of telling the truth they much look down on. No one feels shame before children and animals. Here, Aristotle also returns to sensation by offering the proverb, shame is in the eyes, with the implication that shame inheres in or is conferred by the eyes of the witnesses to the shameful act. Now, in both these passages, Aristotle uses the Greek here is paideia and theria. These are common nouns for children and for beasts. So these creatures, though capable of feeling, according to Aristotle, are not, in this scheme, capable of discerning honorable actions from shameful ones. Nor, in this scheme, are they deemed by Aristotle particularly good at sharing these perceptions, even if they had that capacity. So still, recalling from the Politics that the role of logos in the polis is to convey the perceptions of good and bad, right and wrong, a satisfactory interpretation of these mentions of beasts need at least two different kinds of aesthesis. These are, one, feeling aesthesis, which works across species, and two, deliberative aesthesis, which is discerning abstract ethical or justice-based ideals, such as right and wrong or good and bad. And for Aristotle, these are humans alone. And I want to say, you know, I'm not here going, woohoo, he's right. I'm just I'm trying to parse. The beasts and children round out what is mostly a catalog of opposites designed to privilege the reliability of esteem holders, and that reliability is indexed mainly by opportunities for solid observation. And yet the category exemplified by children and beasts stands alone as something like unreliable narrators. George Kennedy's notion, or his footnote on the passage in the second edition of his translation corroborates such a reading. He writes, the parentheses really applies to those who cannot speak at all, infants and animals. Now, in the first edition, though, of Kennedy's translation, he interprets this, what is actually a diminutive form of beasts as small animals to be kept indoors. So he goes a little far with it. And you'll note, I mean, I think he makes this clarification because I think people made fun of him. So he basically made this note where he retroactively posits, let me show it to you, a witnessing of acts meant to be private. While the second, so here he pretty much says, you know, look at the end there. The adulterer does not much mind if a field mouse observes his actions, but might feel shame in the presence of his horse. So, I love George Kennedy. So, children and beasts, in this passage at least, are distanced, if not excluded, from economies of honor and reputation. But to stop with that exclusion point, or to lean on Kennedy's readings, as I've done before myself, misses this finer point about perception, one that finally, to me at least, helps make these otherwise baffling passages make sense. That is, these passages, these matched parentheticals, you know, children and beasts, help, they actually depend on the distinction between feeling aesthesis and deliberative aesthesis, because the passages turn on a distinction between sheer perception and sheer perception intermingled with perception of right and wrong. So Aristotle is using children and beasts as creatures possessing one but not the other. And they're capable of sensing, sure, but not in the morally discerning way indicated by deliberative aesthesis. Aristotle's mention of children and beasts in Book 6 of Nicomachean Ethics supports my reading, even as it helps draw out the implications of deliberative aesthesis, showing that I work in the sphere of virtue. So here, Aristotle's discussing the way that virtues in this true sense, instead of naturally existing, come to belong to us in another way. You know, think like education or something. And here, as with the rhetoric, Aristotle turns to children and beasts, using the same words. The natural states are already in the dispositions of children and beasts too, but manifestly harmful without discerning intelligence. In fact, he's harsher here. In the Nicomachean Ethics, as with the rhetoric, Aristotle asserts a kind of exceptionalism in the area of moral discernment or deliberative aesthesis. Beasts, along with children, their associated partners, are stamped as non-participants in the most complex and other-dependent, abstract, perceptive feelings of honor and of shame. So read in terms of Richard Zorabji's hypothesis that I mentioned earlier, by which perception is kind of expanded for non-human animals in a compensatory way, this set of exclusions also releases non-human animals, and children as well, into the realm of pure sensation, and that's the category I'm calling feeling aesthesis, where they're able to illustrate, teach, and move through the still important category of feeling in the context of rhetorical theory. Rhetoric, after all, as Aristotle teaches in Book 2, has everything to do with the workings, that is, the reroutings and the routings and reroutings of feelings. And so, on my way to concluding, I'd like to sort through the implications of feeling aesthesis, how it feeds and bends deliberative aesthesis in Aristotle's rhetorical theory. To do so, I'd like to revisit Aristotle's famous chapters on feeling with non-humans at the fore. But first, I want to scoop a couple definitions out of the Deonyma, Aristotle's treatise on the soul, which is the vital principle or animating force of all living beings. It means breath, right? So, first, Aristotle mentions or identifies sensation as the first characteristic of an animal. And the second is where Aristotle further develops this concept of aesthesis, this time by naming its transformative effects rather than its associated states. And that definition rests on two infinitives, kinesthai and paskein, which is a kind of being moved upon and being affected. So here's that definition. Aristotle then offers a justification in that same definition where he says, it that is the sensation, is believed to be a certain alteration. So sensation and pathe both have transformation and movement at their core. And at the opening of Book 2, Aristotle reminds his audience that rhetoric is concerned with making a judgment, thereby tacitly placing rhetoric on abstract ideas, in the land of deliberate aesthesis, since such a judgment would presumably turn on abstract ideas of justice or goodness. Now, the subsequent discussion in the rhetoric, teeming with verbs of perception, clears the way to the treatise's famous discussion of the pathe, or feelings, which Aristotle defines as those things through which, by undergoing change, people come to differ in their judgments, and which follow pain and pleasure. So this definition of pathe is remarkable for any number of reasons, not least of which is the layers of transformation that Aristotle ascribes to pathe. And the relation between sensation and pathe is a direct one. Things appear differently to those who are friendly than those who are hostile. Did anybody see this study of hockey fans who were given something bitter to eat after their team won and it tasted sweeter to them? And so I was thinking about that, Aristotle. Weird. Okay, anyway, he talked about perceived slights and they depend on, his definition of anger, that's what I wanted to look at. He shows here how the layers of perception are necessary to produce that intensity of feeling. He talks about perceived slights, and they depend on the perception of existing hierarchies. In the context, one replays what just happened, trying to make sense out of sense. And here, I wish I could show you, I didn't bring it, but Kennedy's footnote here talks about somebody, damaging somebody's car. And I want to say, dude, there weren't any cars. but it's great. Anyway, so before sense in this cognitive way can be made, the body knows. Heat is already building, cheeks flush, pain or distress has made itself felt, there has been a disturbance. The judgment is in perception, indeed. So this kinetic disturbance of pleasure, pain, and the pathe, bundled as Aristotle thinks they are into sensory parts of the soul, is crucial for the multiple roles animals end up playing in Aristotle's theory of rhetoric. Working through animals' complex conception of feeling and sensation helps to account for why dogs show up in the middle of the treatise and for the pull exerted by non-human animals in the rhetoric. The pull that is toward feeling brings us closer to what might now be called a post-human conception of rhetoric as well, which perhaps, as Catherine Hales would suggest, has been there all along. Thanks.
For questions.
Can you raise your hand to see what speaker?
Yes.
What do you suppose Aristotle would make of the modern day animal communicators, people who feel they can come to comprehend what the animals are feeling and thinking? And there seem to be quite a number of people doing that.
Sure, like the dog whisperer. even a whole range of, yeah. Yeah, I think I just got my daughter a book out of the library that was called How to Speak Dog. and it's a National Geographic book, but that's the kind of, I mean, you're talking about a whole range of things. You know, it's funny, I would like to think that he would say, oh yeah, sure, because of the sound business. I mean, he was pretty observant of, you know, other than Logos ways of communicating is really the way you call it. So, so yeah, I think he would say, totally. He just forgot to write that part down. But there are really interesting moments in the history of animals, and I kind of go on about this in the book, when, you know, he's just fascinated by dolphins, and, you know, who isn't in some ways, but he thinks about the speed with which they'll rise to the surface, and he sort of, that's one place where he complicates one of his claims about calculative reason. He says, I think that dolphins are doing something like, but that's about as far as we'll get there, but doing something like calculation, where they figure out how much, you know, oxygen they have left or something. I mean, he didn't use the word oxygen, but breath. And so that's kind of, those are fascinating moments. Thanks. Yeah.
Something that I love about Greek literature and mythology, and that I think is really striking in relation to your talk, is that, I mean, this stuff is full of human-animal transformation,
mm-hmm.
right? So human, this line between human and non-human is very slippery, I think, in ancient Greek thought. Right? So you have, like, Acteon being turned into a stag and then eaten by his hunting dogs, or, you know, Odysseus has been being turned into swine, and then back again.
Yes.
So, I mean, I wonder, do you think that part of this fixation in Aristotle of trying to define, right, what is the difference between human and animal consciousness is an anxiety like brought by an ancient Greek mindset that was very much like this is not a firmly fixed definition necessarily, and we're constantly afraid, like in the Baka, of losing our humanness and becoming more animal?
I think that I really like that reading. I think that it is kind of the quintessential Aristotelian move to say, all right, let's just get this down, right? Let's just kind of three categories, whatever, you know. And I think that it's a little bit of the sort of need to organize and set things out and record the knowledge or something like that. And you know, there's a little bit of this sort of, I think that a lot of these hedging moments reveal, if not an anxiety about animals creeping in, at least an anxiety about the difficulty of keeping things neat and separate. So I think, yeah, that's about where I come from. It's nice to see your faces. When I was talking, it was like, I was just like, oh, I hope they're all awake.
Yeah. There are some monkeys that have learned sign language.
Yeah, of course.
Do you think that they're just simply recalling like information they've already like learned, or do you think it's like communication? And
I don't know. Today at the grad student meeting, they had me talking about, I was talking about DNA, like genomics. Yeah, I'm talking to you. And I was like, yeah, I'm just going to talk about something I have no idea about, but. But, and that's why, I mean, that's why I keep this book spans in terms of time, and I said this earlier today, but I stopped before sort of enlightenment science in part because of, you know, what happens there. That would be in any other books, I think. But, yeah, I mean, I think that science, you know, these modes of communicating go right along with all modes of communication. So, yeah, sure. I mean, I don't think that it's just, I mean, and also I would say repetition is not a kind of a mere thing in a way. I mean, that's kind of what we're up to anyway, when we wag our tongues. So yeah, it's a neat question. There was somebody, Carly, and then here, and then in the back.
I was just wondering if you could say something about the stakes of your study for our understandings of the history of rhetoric. Are you going to receive, is this a dangerous idea for historians in terms of also opening the door to others, as it has been when we open the door to other excluded groups in the ancient world?
Well, I mean, so the danger would be a perceived one on the part of traditional, maybe, scholars? Mm-hmm. Okay. Yeah, I mean, I think my strategy is, to go at the to try to get at the concepts from within the text that people, the doubters, would revere. And that's one way of doing it. Like, I don't think that's the way of doing it. I think that, you know, I have one graduate student who's working, and she's not, no longer a graduate student, she just got tenure, oh my god. she's not watching. But she did this amazing project on rhetoric in Ecuador, and, you know, the Ecuador is, as some of you know, has almost 20 different constitutions, and so the work of those constitutions, and she looks at visual rhetoric as, you know, part of constituting a nation. So I feel like that is, you know, when she came to move this project, I was like, oh yes, you know, it doesn't all have to happen within, you know, Western text or something like that, but I kind of sneakily, this is sort of one of my things, is to kind of, oh, you like Kenneth Burke, you want to know what he thought? Let's talk about what he thought about, you know, adrenaline, about like hormones. Let's talk about what he thought about hormones and language. And I think that there are times when, you know, I think that book about Kenneth Burke where, you know, I talked about this really awkward moment in Burke's career when he started writing about excrement and people, and there are scholars in Kenneth Burke studies who were like, oh, this was some strange period for Burke. And then, you know, I sort of imagined him kind of typing like this. You know, but I mean, just kind of, okay, no, actually, let's take this seriously. And in fact, that was Burke being, and I know that's not obvious from what I'm saying here, but he was being very ecological. He's being very like, let's not disavow the dirt, people, and stuff like that. And so it was, I think, a very serious point that, you know, if it doesn't fit in with the neat paradigms that people are committed to, then it gets left out. And so I'm sort of, that's what I see as, you know, that's how I would frame kind of positively what I'm up to. Thanks. Let's see.
I just want to return to actually one of the things you said we could discuss later, if so.
Oh, yeah, sure.
Which is actually this distinction or lack thereof then between feeling and emotion. Mm-hmm. This kind of, this whole range of that into affect is a great thing I'm struggling with, and so I'd just like to hear your gloss on that division.
Okay. Now I could just like get into Dropbox and pull up my introduction where I talk about that, just read it to you, but I will not do that to you. So my take on the affect emotion distinction for this project is that it's not super useful because it didn't really apply. I think it's useful, and actually, you know, I could hear it coming up in the kind of, you know, cognitive, the distinction between sort of the cognitive notion of sense and this kind of bodily warmth that I was talking about. But I mean, I think I'm a little concerned about retroactively positing it. So I opt to use feeling, which is much more ambiguous, and it's also loaded in its own way, but I got that move from Anne Spetkovich, and I attribute it to her in the book. In her book, we talked about this briefly in the grad student meeting, she has a book called Depression, A Public Feeling, and it's this amazing book, but she sort of says that she prefers the kind of flexibility of the word feeling to do all that stuff, right? Like, you can know what you're feeling, but maybe you don't, and maybe it's just this inchoate set of energies or something like that, but so feeling can then encompass that. Now I know that they're, you know, Marco, I'm just like, but I think that they're, you know, strategically that, and I actually, you know, made sure in the, you know, in the Greek lexicon that feeling is listed under pathos. I was like, yeah, my faith and philology is hilarious, but yeah, so I think that it could be, and the other thing I would say, and I think I mentioned this in maybe that piece that you all were supposed to read for the grad meeting, but is that when I was first hitting on this sensation business, and I would go out and talk about sensation, people would automatically translate what I was saying back to me as affect. Mm-hmm. And I think that that's a really rich and interesting question, right? Like, what does sensation get us, and what does affect get us? You know, I've worked through some of what I think the answers are there, but I think that, you know, when you think specifically about certain senses, about pain and that kind of stuff, you know, affect comes in a little bit differently, but they both have their own, I see lots of nods, so I'm going, yeah, that's great. So they both have their own work they do, and I'm kind of committed to doing this sensation thing to see where it takes me from here, right? Like, that's sort of what I'm into these days. Does that help? Mm-hmm. And then Daniel, you're up there. Yeah?
Yes. So I have a question kind of going back to this idea of the anxieties surrounding the border of the human in ancient Greek thought. And I was wondering if you could speak a little bit about sort of the fact that if I don't really know enough ancient Greek, but it's anthropos. It's normally being talked about as having logos.
Yeah.
And that's specifically men, right?
Uh-huh.
It's not women, it's not slaves, it's not barbarians. So I was wondering if you could talk a little bit about those categories in relationship to that example and how you see that operating.
Mm-hmm. There's probably a lot to be said there. I mean, there's not utter silence on Aristotle's part. Some of his biological treatises are astonishing for their, accounts of, say, menstruation or something like that. I do think, a lot of people have done work on the kind of alliance, and this was where Haraway got going, right? Like the alliance between the non-human, the historical kind of association between the human, non-human and non-man, right? Non-man humans. I just made that up. I'm sure there's a Greek word for it. I'm so interested. I mean, I have a chapter on fables in the book, and it gets a little bit to the heart of animals in fable as kind of martyrs or witnesses to pain. And I think that it would not be hard to find some very concrete examples of women and of in Greece of slaves and of people from North Africa in these texts that of Aristotle's and others. Some others are even worse, but that do similar, like a similar sort of martyr. And especially when we move into the medieval period, women are right there with non-human animals in kind of the sort of really violent depictions of the zodiac, for example, that are supposed to help people remember the zodiac. So it's a fascinating set of associations that that has gotten some attention and deserves more. I think George Kennedy got in a little bit of trouble because he, I don't know if I want to go down this road. So he, so in the early 90s, George Kennedy, as some of you know, this translator of the rhetoric and of other Greek texts, he also works on the Prognosmata, he started thinking a lot about non-human animals and rhetoric. And he claims that he was walking, he was on the faculty at the University of North Carolina, and he would walk on campus and sort of look up at the crows and say, they are doing rhetoric. And he just imported a lot of Aristotle's categories. He's like, they are doing deliberate rhetoric. it's really fun stuff. So he has this piece, and then he put this piece on animals in a book that he had on comparative rhetoric. And so it was right there next to rhetoric in ancient China and rhetoric. And people got really angry with him. They're like, what are you doing? And it was a good question in many ways, right? So to automatically fold in these categories at certain moments, this was like a early 2000s moment, he got in a bit of trouble. So I'm just riffing a little bit on the question. It's a great one. Thanks. Yes?
Could you explain sort of the particular Greek notion of that aistheia that melds perception, sensation, and aesthetics into a single term?
Sorry, say that again. Did I say that?
Feeling
aesthesis?
Yeah, feeling. Yeah, feeling aesthesis, melding perception, sensation with this idea of aesthetics in the Greek. I don't know how to make what to make of that.
What to make of it? I think that is the term. It's sort of the term I came up with to sort of distinguish the different work that aesthesis is doing for Aristotle. So it's a very Aristotelian group. Like here's one kind and here's another. So one has to do with this sort of what I guess I call pure sensation, which I'm not happy about, but it's as opposed to kind of perception of, you know, the, of goodness or abstract concepts. So it's this like material, it's usually cast for Aristotle in terms of pain and pleasure, at least as I see it. And when I first worked on this, I had a third category of aesthesis, but now I can't even remember what it was. I can get back to you on that. So, no, does that help at all? Okay. Yeah.
Does Aristotle take up, or do you take up, the distinction among non-human animals between wild and tame or domesticated animals? And do they, like the difference between your horse watching and
right. Well, that was Kennedy. Yeah. Right. Yeah.
Like, are we known more and understood more by the animals that have capitulated to our use value and our needs?
Right. Yeah, no. I mean, that comes in, I'm trying to think, the domestication. There's, I'm trying to think where it comes in Aristotle. I mean, they certainly have conceptions, obviously, of, and they did domesticate. And there's a great, great, great collection on, it's an Oxford companion to, or Oxford handbook, I think, to animals in the ancient world that has like a chapter on husbandry and all this stuff. But it's much more ranging, obviously, than Aristotle. I mean, the fascinating question for me is something like a horse, which Aristotle talks about in terms of, you know, somebody's horse, but also in a little bit like a Plato manner, like in the Poetics, sort of an image of a horse or something like that. He invokes this, and I feel like, especially there's a mention in the Poetics about, he says, you know, writers of tragedy want to be really careful to keep the scale to a point where it can be imagined. The scale, and then when he talks about keeping the scale to an imaginable point, he brings in a horse, and my argument there is that the horse was so much part of the everyday life of the Greeks that they can immediately picture the flank that he's talking about, like he mentions the part of the horse. And it's almost, you know, twitching. So I feel like it's not explicit in Aristotle, but it certainly occurred, this idea that there are certain animals that live together and are used in particular ways permeates that part of things. And I go all the way up to Erasmus in this book. And Erasmus is really interesting on this topic because his friend Thomas More had a pet monkey. And Erasmus loved to go watch the pet monkey, and he had like a menagerie, right? So this was the moment when people were collecting, and so that chapter is about kind of this obsession with natural history and with kind of gathering animals and that's nodding, I love it. And so animals and then in Thomas More's case, Erasmus liked to watch them interact with his monkey interact with his weasel, and it makes its way into kind of some of Erasmus's other educational writings as sort of, you know, these animals are interacting in a way where they are thinking, and this gets back to Marcus's question this afternoon. Marcus is here, but the monkey actually thinking about the weasel who was about to hurt the rabbit. That's what it is. And so this sort of ethical, he attributes, anyway, this kind of ethical sensibility, which certainly would complicate where Aristotle sets the line. So I really rambled, but I feel like those categories weave their way in and out, at least in the book I work on, but they're not super central. Yeah. Does that help? Yes.
Going off that, do you mind speaking a bit more on what you see as the relationship of the rhetoric of ethics in a post-human ideology?
Mm-hmm. Right, this came up earlier today too, and I think that this is, I'm going to just give kind of the same answer I did this afternoon, and maybe in slightly different words so that the people don't just fall asleep this afternoon. This comes back, I think, to the distinction between that de Koven makes, and I think that scholars have sort of accepted, between animal studies on the one hand, which tends to to operate in this kind of more, you know, rights-based ethics, realm, right? And then the animality studies, which de Koven says aligns itself with post-humanism, right? So worries a little bit more about how the distinction gets made between non-human and human animals, okay? So the way de Koven puts it, it almost seems like, you know, the animal studies realm gets all the, you know, moral credibility. And I just from just finishing this book, I would come up against, you know, I start with the post-human stuff because the question of the division between humans and non-human animals drove this book from the beginning. And but it seems to me that these aren't separable inquiries, right? So de Koven does it pretty quickly, and I think people just kind of sided her like I did. But then, you know, the act of doing the research, I have come up against moments where I sort of say, now wait a minute, if we follow Erasmus, you know, pretty far here, what are we doing? I mean, it's the anxious moment of, you know, I think that's shared by eco-criticism and the, you know, I'm afraid you have humans moment, right? And so, yeah, this is me just kind of wringing my hands, but I think that it's a real concern that these two things need to be taken together and not separated so easily. Does that help? Yeah, thanks. And I appreciate this lecture series for giving me a chance to sort of think about this, because that's not, I mean, I have lots of footnotes in the book about this kind of issue, but I don't, you know, cast the book in terms of post-humanism, because that's not exactly, you know, where the conversation, I'm in the kind of animal studies realm, and I'm like, you know, why are you leaving out rhetoric? So there's lots of battles to be fought, I guess. Yeah?
Just listening to the examples, and it seems that we started talking about the dog whisperer, et cetera, it seems that a lot of the animals that we're kind of tying to this rare thing are ones that are pretty easily personified, like your dog, your horse, are these, basically, how deep are we going as far as the animals go? Are we just kind of sticking with ones, I guess, your typical warm-blooded animals, or are we going a little further on that?
Oh, yeah, this is where I get to talk about bed bugs. Does that sound good? Because I have some stuff on bed bugs in this
book. Yeah, I haven't read it.
No, you haven't read it because it's not there.
I mean, you see a lot of dogs, chimps, horses, etc., and then you rash this with, you know, your pets.
Good, yes. Right. Yeah. Well, there are, in this question came up today, but there's a whole range of animals that crop up in the context of rhetorical theory, and one really interesting one is this set of insects and teeny tiny bugs that can barely be seen. Where I work on this set of little speeches of praise that this Byzantine guy wrote, Michael Pselos wrote, in I think the 11th century, and he wrote one like in praise of the louse, in praise of the bedbug, and in praise of the flea, and then I think there's another one in praise of the flea. I think there are two of the flea, and it's almost like that, remember that slide on epidictic where Aristotle says, it doesn't matter what you're talking about, you have to do these values. So it's almost a, like a hyperbolizing of that, or just like taking that order and going with it. I'm just like, let me praise something that never occurred to you to praise. and so then what, you know, the question there becomes kind of what work does this mode of praise, however insincere it might be, or joking, what work does that do for the kinds of rhetorical values that are getting reinstantiated? You know, when there's this, like, and so that chapter ends up thinking about this idea of animals and wonder, that, and the kind of wonder and marvel that they seem to inspire. And here it's like the minuscule and the miniature and the, wow, this tiny little thing has a lot of power when it has infested your scalp or something, you know. So that's sort of what that chapter focuses on, but I don't know if that's starting to... I'm trying to get what's behind your question. Is this a Derrida question?
No, we apply a lot of rhetoric towards animals that we really personify.
Okay. That's why I think it sounds like the Derrida
question. Like your typical cat is like, the cat was really happy, or was it really happy? You know what I'm saying?
Right. Yeah, I hope you don't hear me saying that.
Yeah.
No, yeah, there's a whole range. There's birds, snakes, you name it. I can't wait to do an index for this book. I really can. If it was $1,000 or something.
I love it.
So what do we have? Maybe one or two more questions,
yeah,
something like that?
One more.
One more? Thanks.
In your opinion, what is like the distinguishing features of being human? Is it the degree to which we're able to X, or is there some capacities that humans seem to have that just nothing else seems to have?
I have the ability not to stand up straight. I think that the question itself is so fascinating. I wonder why. I don't worry so much about where the line. You want my opinion on where the line? Yeah, I don't really. I'm not sure humans are so special. It's just like that. You know what I mean? What about you?
Maybe the ability to which we're able to have forethought.
So yeah, I mean that's Aristotle talks about that, and he talks about we can think about something that's happened, act differently. So there's this funny. He fusses with that a little bit too. Kenneth Burke, another favorite in this room, says it's our ability to talk about talking, right? So this kind of reflection, and we don't know what those birds are saying to each other. So I think that it's difficult to sort of presume. Yeah. Thanks.
Well, whether or not humans are the only ones that have forethought, I hope that you will have the forethought to put our next event October 20th calendar. Join me in thanking you.